this one pocket here and the another pocket here, which are together about 9% of that 1,000 hectares for the purposes of commercial in the sense which can be sold to raise resources for development. Because I think the idea that land can never be used for this kind of purposes is no good. There are many examples which show that a very small proportion of land when used for raising resources can help you develop a much bigger area. You know, Bandra Kurla itself is an example. The real high price Bandra Kurla land is only 120 hectares, and that can service large amount of infrastructure. There is a project going on in Ahmedabad, which is the Sabarmati Riverfront development, and their merits are apart. It's using only 5% for commercial purposes to finance entire development of Sabarmati Riverfront. So location at the vantage locations, if exploited cleverly, can generate a lot of resources. So the whole new argument which is coming up is monetizing public lands is one of the important ways of raising funds for urban development. So it captures all those things and the land uses.
I think the term that people use is monetizing a fraction of the fraction.
The fraction is your wisdom. Huh? If you're a fool, you will squander everything. But the notion that public land is not something which should never be used commercially, now that is not a thing. In fact, it ends up being wasted, you know, if you don't use it cleverly. These are some of the examples of what has been done elsewhere. So making specific provisions of land uses is important. It can't be left as loosely defined no development zone. Land in RA colony is owned by government, and therefore government can decide when and how to use it. So it's not throwing RA to developers, which has been, of course, a criticism. And institutional and open use is the main notion of this plan. That 61% of the land is still maintained as green, and green in a hard-coded green, not as no development zone. And 9% used for commercial purposes, and 9 or 10% used for institutional uses. And when and how to use it is really by way of seizing opportunities. It's not to be done tomorrow for malls. Malls themselves are closing down. So that may not be a wise thing to do. So this is what RA is about, and this is an example of riverfront development, how that is being done. Okay. Again, some.
When the country is, for example, RA, so many trees, that's probably the main objection is.
That could be planned. That's the second stage. Because this is what I was emphasizing. This is towards seizing opportunities. Once the concept is decided, you could do a much more detailed plan for this. This is only a broad zoning. You can then do the tree survey, the detailed topographical survey. Then you can decide how to go about it. The plan won't do everything, at least.
No, I mean, plan is one thing, and of course, many of the objections perhaps stem from the healthy suspicion that people have about the implementation.
But that's the problem. In the sense, it's true, I think, that suspicion, looking at the past, etc., is a problem. But unless sound proposals are put forward, that will not change. There is some hope then that if you have a wisely construed proposal put in the public domain, then things might change.
The only one way that I would say, maybe goes into other areas that you are talking about. In general, the love for trees is found missing, if I may say so. Even when you talk about footpaths, only beyond 27 meter, you talk about a tree as a part of the footpath. Otherwise, footpaths are not having trees for smaller ones. And in the process, in general, whatever loss of trees that has happened, there is no concept of recovering from that.
See, what I'm seeing is that you have a footpath which is less than 2 meter wide and you put a tree on that. Neither the tree survives nor the footpath is.
So
you have to be careful in terms of doing that.
Right.
If you have a,
But things are happening that way. The footpaths are reduced, the trees are still there outside the footpath. So it doesn't serve the purpose of widening the carriageway, nor does it serve the purpose of having at least a minimum footpath there, because trees are still standing out. So there are issues on that, and I won't claim that DP has tried to solve those kind of issues.
What about slum areas? Are they not touched by the DP?
Slum areas are identified, and they have been put in the zones where the RCCR is there, and their redevelopment according to the existing policies with some amount of change is made permissible. So there are no specific proposals, because there has been already a policy which has been in place for last 20 years, and which essentially depends upon a promise of free house to slum dwellers. And we didn't want to disturb that thing. And therefore, what we have tried to do is change the incentive patterns for doing those kind of things, and also made the slum development regulations on par with rest of it. You know, slum buildings, they had a lot of concessions. Those 8-story buildings can be built at 3 meters apart and those kind of things. We have removed all that, you know, but we are not shouting on the rooftop for that, because that has its own implication. But quietly, it has been brought on par with the rest of the buildings.
So what about the slum population? Apparently the accusation is, I don't know how valid it is, but that the slum population has not been counted in there for the amenities.
14 million population for next 20 years, will it not include slum population?
No, parameters like amenities per
they account. I think what had happened when the existing land use survey was done, there were people who were criticizing that slums have not been surveyed.
Okay.
By that they meant every hut not being marked.
Yeah.
Now that was impossible. I mean, if you are doing a 450 square kilometer of city planning, you can't be doing individual hut and all that. That is being separately done also.
As far as the metro is concerned, that metro car shed has been planned. Uh-huh. Is there a station also there?
We have presumed that there is a station. That is why that commercial.
Because the problem is that if you don't have a station in the RA area, then that area becomes inaccessible because you have to cross JVLR.
That's true. The assumption is that along with the thing that there will be.
The colony, the playground and whatnot. While I cannot go from JVLR very close by into that area, you know, by car, I mean, by wheel.
No, that is where the road network has also been indicated, how it will be made accessible. And it is also assumed that the car shed will also have a terminating station. On that basis that
some of this development has been is important. Problems.
No, I think there is a second stage of planning. Everything
not with those details faster. I must take that.
I think that is why I'm saying this is a broad brush plan. It has to be followed by a more detailed plan. And particularly in case of RA, it's a question of seizing opportunities when they come. And you hold it till then. You know, we are not saying do it tomorrow. See, look at the things, how the opportunities come, whether you really need to make government land available in order to get that things in a competitive fashion, then you go ahead.
More hot topic on FSI. What this presentation sort of contains is evolution of FSI, because I think FSI of Mumbai has to be seen in its evolutionary trajectory. It can't be seen what has been proposed now. because otherwise you will miss the thing. That is why most of these discussions that, oh, now you are saying from 3.5 to 8, etc. But that 3.5 was already available. Currently, building activity in suburbs is happening at 3 to 5, 4 FSI. So that has to be understood and why that the case is. What is the existing FSI? Existing in the sense consumed FSI, you know, what the city has consumed. Estimation of required built up area by 2034, and then calculating what is the mean FSI. So for that you need what is going to be the plot area available for building activity. And then how that mean FSI could vary, because you can't have a flat FSI in the city. No city is flat in terms of accessibility. Some plots are facing a wider road, 60 feet, some are not, some are on the corner, some are on the midway, some are on the gullies, some are close to railway stations, and all these accessibility patterns should decide what is the intensity of development that you are allowing in that. And if you don't do that and have a flat FSI, that means you are underutilizing the city. So the FSI pattern has to vary, and I think Mumbai is perhaps the only city which attempts to show that we have a flat FSI, 1 and 1.33. No other city, not even Chennai, has flat FSI. Ahmedabad now varies its FSI from 1.8 to 5.7. Leave aside others, you know, all other cities have a much varying FSI, but even in Indian cities, that is not the case. So how should that, taking that mean FSI, how should it vary against that mean? So that will be one next step. Then we have proposed a four-tier structure for that FSI. FSI is not available just like that, but it's in four layers. Linked issue is of TDR and also of incentives which are granted for slums and cess building redevelopment. And if we do all this, what are the likely outcomes in terms of what happens to the city? So in 1967, for the first time in 64 actually, by way of draft regulation, FSI was introduced in Mumbai. Prior to that, there was no FSI as the concept. Building activities were governed by the ground coverage and the number of stories. So if you see typical development of that, like Hindu colony and Parsi colony, 1/3 ground coverage, 3-storied. So that gave one FSI. That was the common practice. But in 67, when the plan was approved, the first formal development plan, then Nariman Point had 4.5, that is Air India and around that. Corporate residential development had 3.5. Colaba, Marine Drive, Ballard Estate had 2.45. which was closer to what was already there. If you calculate, Ballard Estate of course had higher than 2.45, but Marine Drive and Colaba areas, planned layouts of Colaba area had about 2.45. Karba Devi, Girgaon, Mandvi, in contrast, they had already consumed FSI of the order of 4 to 5, because whole plot was virtually covered and they had 4 to 5 storied buildings, so it accommodated much higher FSI. But the prescribed FSI was only 1.66. And for Malabar Hill, Varali, Dadar, Sion, etc., the FSI prescribed was 1.33. In a way, you will find that when the consumed FSI 1 in this area, it allowed one more story to be added. That is why it became 1.33 FSI. 0.33 ground coverage, 3-storied already built, you add one more story, it became 1.33. This is again Mumbai speciality in a way, because no other city defines FSI as in 0.33, etc. They are much rounded numbers. And the entire suburbs has one FSI. Now what general impression is, one is a good FSI and it should not be exceeded. What was good about one FSI of that plan was that along with one FSI, it had a much wider area which was allowed for residential growth. And if you were to calculate what population it could have contained at those densities, because in those days a common housing unit was one bedroom, 400, 450 square feet house. That was how most of Mumbai was built in that decade, 60s and early 70s. Suburbs could have accommodated 1 crore population. So for the real estate market, it provided that space that though the population by 81 would not have exceeded 1 crore, it provided a physical space which could have, in theory, accommodated 1 crore population. Now, this is the point which is being missed when people presume that one FSI is God-given and that is should not be exceeded. So what you have in 1991, 1.33 flat FSI in the island city, and in suburbs, 1 FSI. What happened in 1991 is that as compared to the old residential land that was available in the previous plan, that land shrunk because no development zones were introduced, which were earlier not there. And the CRZ also, along with that, removed lot of development from lot of land from development possibilities. Those of you who are familiar with, say, Andheri West, Andheri stopped at Dake Colony. All that has happened towards Warsawa is on the land which would not have been developed after 91 because it was all coastal wetland. Or Charkop development is entirely on coastal wetland. Which was done in 82, the reclamation started in 82. Had it to be done after 91, it wouldn't have been possible. So all such lands went out of development. So the land shrunk, FSI remained what it was, population grew. What was the idea that when, you want to ask right away? Yeah. Okay. FSI is a ratio of total floor space to plot area. So if you have a 100 square meter plot and FSI is 1, that means you can build 100 square meters on that plot. Suppose you cover only 50% of the plot area by your plinth, then you can build a two-storied building. So you will have 1 FSI. Okay, it's a ratio of... Now, why did planners insisted on lowering FSI and not increasing 1 FSI? I think the presumption was that by controlling FSI, you can control population and density, both. Once you control density, on the city scale, you control population also. Both have proved to be myths. That is not how things happen. So what it really resulted that the population of 1991 plan, the assumed population of 1991 plan up to 2001 for a 20-year period is going to be 9.8 million. That was the assumption on which the previous plan was based. The actual population of 2001 of Mumbai was 11.9 million. So population itself has had grown beyond that. So as compared to that population, and not just the population grew, but the incomes also, income and economy also grew faster. From mid-80s to almost 2000, Mumbai had a much faster economic growth. And housing finance also improved. 1987, National Housing Bank was established, and it created considerable ease of accessing housing finance, at least those people who had formal jobs, I mean, even if you leave aside the informal jobs. The generations prior to that, they depended upon father's provident fund or father-in-law's dowry for buying a house. That was the way in which how housing was financed. From mid-85, with HDFC, NHB, all the banks coming into housing finance, the ease of housing finance improved. Now you find young people entering the job market. Immediately, the housing finance agencies are after them to borrow money for house. So that has changed a lot. So the houses that are built are much bigger. I mean, if you recall what was built in 60s and 70s as compared to what is being built in last, now it has again becoming smaller because of the real crunch in terms of prices. But flats became bigger. At one stage in Mumbai, you couldn't have found a one-bedroom apartment. All advertisements were two, three, three and a half bedrooms, etc., etc. So the houses became bigger. What it resulted in is that scarcity of development rights in the market. So if what FSI created was the scarcity of development rights in the market. And if you squeeze the supply side, prices are bound to go up. Now people are not ready to accept that, but I don't know why. And if you ease the, there are two things which happen. Where the police power is very strong, the prices go up. Where the police power is weak, the prices go up and the smuggling also starts. And that is exactly what has happened in case of FSI in Mumbai. So sometimes, whether I don't know whether I should repeat that, but many times I compare the FSI regime of Mumbai with prohibition. If you have very strong prohibition, then you have bootleggers. But if you relax that, you can manage it better. So that is the story on FSI. So that is why in this plan, we have called a need for paradigm shift on FSI. So FSI is not a tool of containment of growth and density. That is the first thing which should be understood. If you don't understood, and that is what happened in the last 20 years, you could neither contain growth nor density, but supply side intervention increases prices. And not just prices, but it increases scope for rent seeking, malpractices, and all those things that come with that. And therefore, in Mumbai, you had cases where a 350 square feet flat was shown, but eventually it could be made into a 1500 square feet flat because two car parking spaces were shown very close to the flat. And car parking spaces are free of FSI. Those sort of things, or flower beds, you know, these were very common things which the developers use. Flower beds, lily ponds, you know, they are not meant to be. You can't have a flower pot and lily pond on the fifth story unless you are going to use it for something else. So we are saying in the new paradigm, you must define the FSI regime in such a fashion that at any given time and at any given location, there should be adequate scope for building activity to take place. It should not be exhausted fully, because if you exhaust it, then all those kind of problems begin to happen. FSI, again, was because it was so tightly controlled, it became an entitlement. So everybody said that you have put one FSI, so I must be allowed to consume one FSI. Even if your plot is very small, you will say, no, I must consume full FSI. And in the process, what you did that I may be allowed not to provide the open spaces which are required around the building. And BMC was very happy because they could condone that open space by asking for money. Money in official fee, not under, over, etc. Now, if you turn these kind of concessions into a fiscal measure, it has a serious implication. Because the amount that BMC collects from these kind of condonations, it's substantial. So there is no incentive for rationalizing regulation. So if you convert your regulations into fiscal instrument, the incentive for rationalizing regulation goes away. So what we are saying here is that FSI should not be treated as an entitlement. FSI is indicative, it is shown there. If your plot is good and adequate to consume that, you can consume. Otherwise, you cannot consume. You will consume lower FSI. The implication of that is that if there is a real urge to consume full FSI, people will bring their land together and then they can consume that FSI with proper open spaces around buildings. Using scarcity of development rights for achieving policy objectives. That is again what government did. You know, so you create scarcity first by your regulation and then use scarcity and attendant high prices for your so-called social and developmental objectives. Now, how did they do it? They said if somebody is ready to build free houses for slum dwellers and rent-controlled tenants, you will get incentive FSI. You will get more FSI. If you want to build IT-ITES, you will get double the FSI, even in the no development zone. And there have been such developments where too far from the railway station or any of the development, there are two FSI IT, ITS buildings built. You want to build schools, you want to build hospitals, you will get double the FSI. You want to build five-star hotels because they are necessary to promote tourism, you will get five FSI. If you are ready to shift the buffalo stables, you will get extra FSI. If you want to build parking, you will get extra FSI. So this is a strange logic. You first create scarcity, then use scarcity and the prices to promote these sort of things. So we said, all this is not desirable. So we have retained the incentive FSI only for slum redevelopment and the redevelopment of cess buildings, the tenanted buildings. All other incentives have been removed. In the new regulations, you won't find any of these kind of things which are linked to FSI. And a simplified definition of FSI has been used. The law defines FSI in very simple terms. All the covered areas on all floors divided by plot, that is FSI. Very easy to understand, there is no problem. But if you read today's regulations, you will not understand anything. Because there is a long list of activities which are not counted in FSI. Now if you have this, from a governance perspective, this is an open field for rent seeking. And there were architects, now I am trained as an architect, never practiced as architecture, but there were architects in Mumbai who were specializing in this. So where officially 2.7 FSI is possible, they will get you 6, 8, 9 FSI. This is a scatter diagram showing FSI on x-axis, density on the y-axis. And each of those dots are the 150 planning sectors. Mumbai was divided into 150 planning sectors, which shows that the prescribed FSI or consumed FSI has nothing much to do with density. Because FSI and size of the dwelling units together define density. Where now you see very tall buildings going up, they are not necessarily very high density. You know, the slums are probably higher density than those kind of buildings. I have used this. It's not a very refined economic analysis, but I think it makes sense in terms of graphically explaining how you should decide FSI in an economic sense and not in the planners thou shalt do kind of presumption. This is the y-axis shows prices, x-axis shows built-up area. And in Mumbai, since land is not very flexible, it's essentially FSI because land is not cannot be increased. A demand curve where the demand increases as the prices go down. And a supply curve where supply increases as the prices go up. This is the equilibrium, market equilibrium. And if we assume that this is what was the situation in 67, that this is where the market was operating, the FSI land composite representing on the y-axis was the 67 situation, that it was to the right of the equilibrium. So it did not create any distortion in the market. Market never wanted to go up to that line immediately. It was happy with remaining on this Q1, P1 combination. What happened by 91 when the plan, the next plan was approved? The demand has gone up for the reasons I was explaining. The increase in income, ease of housing finance, et cetera, et cetera. The demand curve moved. So what could have happened is that the market could have built Q2 as P2 prices. But we did not allow that to happen. We said, no, you can't go beyond this green line. I'm using green more deliberately. You did not allow the green line to be exceeded. In fact, we moved it leftward because CRZ had eaten away into land and FSI was also suppressed. Naturally, prices went to P3. And people feel that increasing FSI is in favor of developers. Actually, developers need not be very unhappy. If you just calculate the area of this rectangle, it may not be very different as compared to this rectangle. In fact, instead of doing Q2, they can now do Q3, but still get more or less similar revenues. Of course, you need much finer analysis. What are the elasticities of those curves, et cetera, but leaving apart, that may not be a very. This supply line also includes in itself the cost of transaction, which is because of very complex regulations, leaving aside possibilities for rent seeking, et cetera, but very complex regulations, time consuming. If we manage to move the supply curve downwards, you get a still better output. You can get Q4 at P4 prices. Now, if that is the case, then where should the FSI line be drawn? We don't know what Q4 is. First of all, that this is all very conceptual. No numbers can be attached. There is no data available. If you are attempting to do evidence-based planning, it's impossible in Mumbai. And I think that could be one of the academic or research challenges. How do you turn city planning into an evidence-based planning? Because traditionally, planning is axiomatic. It has been guided by visionaries of old days like Ebenezer Howard or Le Corbusier or those kind of things. So what is to be done is very axiomatic. And the Government of India guidelines as UDPIF, which says that you must provide 10 to 12 square meters per person as open space. Now, if you do that, you will have to vacate Mumbai because you cannot provide that kind of open space. So I think the line has to be drawn something like blue, where you might allow Q4, P4 to operate, and not necessarily go right up to the blue line. Lot of criticism is appearing because of not understanding the purpose of defining this. People are saying that when we say that this plot will be 8 FSI, as if we are saying that you must build 8 FSI. Not saying so. We are saying if you want and your plot and other circumstances are conducive to that, then you can go up to 8 FSI. Or we are saying when you have a 6.5 FSI, it doesn't mean tomorrow everybody is going to go to 6 FSI. Even if you recall, the 67.1 FSI in Mumbai was prescribed till 70s, almost early 80s, not all plots had consumed 1 FSI. There were many bungalows in Khar and such areas which were still at lower. Some of them are still there, not consumed 1 FSI. So it's not that everything sort of jumps into that. But it is important that you create that framework for the market to operate competitively. If you create scarcities, market will react in a different fashion.
FSI that you talk about, earlier FSI was with a lot of exemptions. The present system that has been proposed, does it have a similar
No exemption. That is right. We have gone back to the definition in the law. all covered areas divided by plot.
No anti-mandi by architects.
Covered means
it has a roof. So all areas which have a roof.
Basically, where this can be used in a different fashion is the cover, because if you
use pergola type of covering over a parking space, that becomes uncovered. So is the covered definition quite exhaustive?
No, covered, the law hasn't also defined covered. So covered means which has a roof over it. And parking itself is part of the parking is exempted from
that
the
is actually used by architects to increase or
to provide like, shade.
Not only shade but also FSI.
And then cover the pergola also. So
yes,
those things were done. Yeah.
So when you're saying that 8 is the maximum FSI and it's inclusive of everything, that means 8 in today's
I'll come to
previous
that.
Calculation, it will come
to that. It's about 70%.
Yeah.
About 70%. So 8 is equivalent to 5.6
5.
Of today's FSI. So what? How can we estimate? You know, one of the ways of trying to define that blue line is to estimate what Mumbai would need by 2034 in terms of total built-up area, and that is anybody's guess. So we have done our guess to say how that would be done with some rationale. So step one is to assess space demand. Step two is estimating the net plot area available in Mumbai and calculating mean FSI. Now this is the housing situation of Mumbai. The first column shows the deciles of households arranged according to rising income. And then you will find that nearly 40% of the population has 4 square meters or less per capita housing space. And only 20% have more than 21. Square meters per capita per space. And the average is 9 square meters. If you look at what is the current consumption for housing space, there are 139 planning sectors which have residential population out of 150. And there you find that 15 out of 139 planning sectors have 3 square meters per person as the per capita space. Another 52 have only 6 square meters per as the per space, and the average is 9. Okay, so that is balanced. Now, for each of these rows, which shows the current situation, what would be the floor space requirement in 2034? So, what we have tried to do, there are 6 of these. So we have envisaged 6 profiles of per capita space. So the first profile, which is perhaps dominated by slum dwellers as of now, or the chawl dweller, will have 14 square meters per person as the average size. And it will sort of increase to 50. So each of those 6 rows will have these averages in terms of floor space. And then if you calculate the average, it will come to about 27 square meters per capita. Now, many people have said, oh, what is this? You want to create heaven on Mumbai, you know, from 9 to 27. Now, 9 to 27 is not saying that 27 has to be built. Or some people have asked, is there an engineering capacity to build so much of floor space? If it is not there, it will not be built. I mean, we are not saying that it must be built. But this is towards that blue line. And knowing that, things will be on the left-hand side of the blue line and will not be crossing the blue line. So if we do that logic and also add some floor space for work areas, that is industry, offices, commercial activities, etc. The total that will be required is about 440 square kilometers of built up. Now, when we said that 27 square meters per capita, how does it look like in the other cities? Hong Kong has 30, but Hong Kong is known to be very dense city with very small apartments. Singapore is 23, Shanghai 25, aspiring to go to 34. And once they say aspire, they do it. But by different means, but that is the kind of thing that city is trying to do. Seoul has 20, and Manhattan, of course, has 55. So saying 27 may be optimistic, but it's not totally optimal. What is the net plot area that Mumbai has on which buildings can be built? The total area is 458 square kilometers, and you have only 140 square kilometers on which you can build the buildings. Rest of the area goes in national parks and public purposes like roads, transport, railways, some of the defense establishments. So what you really have is only 140 square kilometers. Now this raises an interesting issue. If you want 1 square meter to be added per person as open space and 14 million population, you need 14 square kilometers of area. And that has to be carved out of this 140, where there are already existing buildings and existing population. So, how to create that additional open space policy? You will have to demolish buildings, resettle people, and then create gardens. Now, if Mumbai has the will to do that, then it could be done. But we have not proposed, because I don't think that is a feasible proposition. Now, if you want to accommodate 440 square kilometers of built-up area on 140 square kilometers of land, then you need on an average 3 acres. So as I was raising that question, what profile should we adopt so that we get 3 or near about that? So we have used 3 things. What is the existing FSI, which is already consumed? Because you can't specify a lower FSI, you know, like we had done earlier. Where 4 and 5 FSI was there, we had put 1.66. Then we granted all kinds of exemption for people to restore those buildings. So we can't really do that. We need a cushion for the activities to go on. Accessibility to public transit, that has been given a much higher priority in terms of where FSIs could be used. And we have then so the consumed FSI pattern, if you see, the island city has 1.3, the Malabar in particularly at 1.3, and 4 and above in the congested areas, Gurgaon, Kalbadevi, Mandi, Nar Bazar, these are very high FSI. Nar Bazar has particularly above 4 FSI. And suburbs at 0.928. So we used these kind of maps. I think I will read it from right to left. What is the existing FSI, which is already consumed? What is the proximity to employment location?
You had said that we don't have the data of the existing built-up area and
this was done rather crudely during the existing land use survey. What was done was the building footprints were taken from the satellite imagery, and sample blocks were examined in terms of heights, and then the total bulk was calculated. So what is exempted, what is non-exempted, those fine calculations could be done. So this is why we are calling it as bulk FSI. The first was the existing consumed FSI, second was the proximity to employment location. So you have Fort, you have here Barali mill area, Bandra Kurla, seeds, and here the mine space and that emerging area, and of course smaller employment location. So proximity to employment location was one criteria. Then you have the TOD zones, particularly the transit stations, both railways and metros, etc. And with a hierarchy, where you have two or three lines intersecting, that node has a higher priority or higher weightage, and accordingly it is structured. And also, the sort of transit buffer along the route also, not just that railway system, along the route also. And that has given some this is what it's what we call as logic map. Some weightages, etc., were granted, they were combined, and then you had weightage going from 0 to 15 kind of thing, which was then translated into this. So this shows the logic map and FSI map. So FSI varied from 2 to 8. But what was the what was the proportion of those FSIs? I think that has to be seen. That these very light areas, not easily accessible, etc., was given the lowest 2 FSI, and that accounted for 5% of the total area. The next is 3.5 FSI, which is largely in the suburbs, this darker yellow shade, which is all over the suburbs. That accounts for 58% of the project, total project. Then 5 FSI is 32%, and this is this shape, which is largely in this area where the existing FSI themselves are on a higher scale. And also along the transit routes in all the suburban areas. And 6.5 accounts for only 4.5% of the plot area. And that is this slightly darker color, which is at the nodes. And 8 FSI, which is only on 0.46% of the plot area, total plot area, which is at Dadar and Andhra. That is how this FSI profile has been built up. Now if you calculate that, it goes up to not just 3, but it goes up to 4. If you do really average because of this existing, because of the requirement of prescribing FSI more than what has already been considered. Now that pushes up the thing. Now, whether this is likely to be realized in the next 20 years, there are a lot of ifs and buts. For example, if you go to Andheri Kurla Road, where a lot of new development has occurred at 2.5 FSI or 2.7, which was permissible, that's not going to immediately go in for demolition and reconstruction to reach 6.5 FSI. If there are very small, tiny plots around Andheri station and they don't want to amalgamate and they want to remain as they are because they are running their own businesses, it won't go to it. So the fear that plan is telling everybody, look, this is your FSI and you must consume it tomorrow. That is not the case. It is still creating only a framework within which, if things happen, they can go up to that. Because the characteristics of the location and land is such that such exercises are possible. Now this graphically shows, now that four layer thing, I think that is another, in a way, a dampener in reaching 8 FSI. Now that I will take. What this graph shows is the four layers of FSI. Now if you are in 8 FSI zone, up to 2.5 FSI, you don't have to pay anything. If you want to get additional 2.5, then you have to pay at the rate of 70% of ready rate. And you are familiar with ready rate. Right? So then 0.5 you have to obtain through TDRs. And additional 2.5, you have to buy at 100% of ready rate. Then you can go to it. Similar is the case with 6.5, 5.5, and this is the case most prevalent as proposed in suburbs. So this is 2 FSI without any charge, 0.5 paid at 70%, 0.5 TDR, and 0.5 paid at 100%. Now, how does it differ from the current situation? Currently, in suburbs, you are allowed 1 FSI as the base. You can bring in additional 1 as TDR you have to purchase it in the market, and then you can take additional 0.7, what is being called as compensatory fungible FSI, and for that you have to pay 60 to 80% of regulation. Now, as compared to this, we are saying 3.5. So 2.7 was permitted, but within that, some of the areas were not counted, like staircase, lifts, lobbies were not counted in that. So that 2.7 was almost equivalent to over 3. May not be exactly 3.5, but over 3. And out of that, only one was available without payment. Now, we are saying you can get 3.5, but out of that, 2 you can get without anything.
You say without any payment, payment to whom?
Yes, payment to BMC.
The tax.
Not that, the premium.
Premium to whom?
These layers are all, the lower layer is without any premium. The other layers come with a financial tag, either as premium or as purchased TDR. Yes. Now this is showing this in terms of volume. So 0.8 is only 0.46% of plot area, 0.45% of plot area for 6.5, 32% for 5 FSI, and 58% for 3.5 FSI. So the range between 3.5 and 5 really covers 80% of 80% of plot.
TDR average
towards the north. No, I'll come to that. So what are the mitigating measures against excessive FSI? One is, of course, the requirement of amalgamated plots. On small plots, you cannot consume. Minimum road widths have been prescribed for each of these FSI. Unless that road width is available, you will not be able to do that. This is your question. The way TDR was structured in the previous plan was that TDR was one-to-one. So irrespective of where the TDR originates, where you use, if the ratio is same, one-to-one. You generate 1 square meter in Phalaba and you transfer it to Bandra or Thar, one remains one, irrespective of the variation in prices. The idea was that the TDR must flow from high value areas to low value areas and not other way around. So therefore the condition was that TDR cannot be used in the island city. It has to be only used in suburbs and in the northerly direction. Assuming that northerly direction means low value. But that was a very gross generalization. People use that, but they transferred the TDR from Manpur to Thar. That is northerly, but not westerly. And the TDR still moved from low value areas to high value. So here what we have done, we have related to the land values. Of course, in those days, these ready reckoner practices were not established and stabilized. So there was no good way of adjusting it. So now what we are saying that if you are transferring from high value to low value, you will get an add-on. Suppose you are transferring 1 square meter from a 1000 value area to 500 value area, your 1 will become 2. And if you are doing reverse, your 1 will become half. So that is how it is, and there is no directional limitation. So it can go anywhere and it can still be used. But the quantum will change in the reverse proportion of the land prices. Now in case of, again, and this is linked one, this is the incentives which you are granted. So if you are building 100 square meters for slum dwellers, you would get 100 square meters for sale, or 133 per sale. Irrespective of in which location you are operating. Similarly, was the case with cess building. So if you are building for the tenants, then whatever you are building for tenants, you could get 50 to 80% of that as incentive FSI on the same plot, irrespective of what the total FSI is. So they have tried to change that also. And this is some strange formula has been arrived at. The details are in the report. But what it is saying is that the incentive must vary with the relative property prices to the land price and the construction cost. So if you are in a zone where the high property prices are there, then you will get less incentive. But if you are doing it in a low property price zone, then you will get higher incentive. And common formula will apply for both slum and resale. So say for example, you are in Paita, Kamadipur area, you will get 61% of the rehabilitation floor space as incentive. But if you are in Nanachau, which is a high value area, you will get only 65%. And if you are doing it in Mandale, which is way out in the Chembur area, you will get 86% incentive. As against in Villeparle, you will get 66%. Now one will feel that this scale is not so distinguishing. Villeparle 66 and Mandale 86. But that has also become a very contentious issue because people are used to 100 and 133, then they have gone down to 86. Of course, they are agitating. These are, of course, minor. Then we have also provided for so-called inclusionary housing. So if your plot is more than 2,000 square meters, then you have to provide 10% of the base FSI. So if you are in 2.5 zones, then you have to provide 0.25 FSI extra in the form of smaller units, and those units have to be handed over free of cost to BHC.
That is 10%.
It used to
earlier
20%,
right?
20% with one FSI.
Yes.
And we have made 10% of the base FSI. So in terms of physical quantum, it is slightly higher. And the plot size has also been brought down to 2,000 instead of 4,000. So if all these things are done, what is the expectation? The FSI will become a tool for managing physical development and not a way of achieving all kinds of objectives all over the places, like right from buffalo resettlement to slum dwellers resettlement. Everything may not be covered through FSI. You will find that now government has, in this government budget also, they have increased the pricing for its parking. So government is also trying to extract, not just BMC. The government also looks at BMC in real estate as a way of raising resources, despite 74th and all other amendments in the constitution.
But that leads to more number of parking spaces being constructed.
No, I mean that I'm citing. Our plan has not proposed that.
No.
Parking will be a different thing. I'm not presenting that. So it will not distort the market, the restrictions, which are 20-year restrictions. So the restrictions are such that it will still allow the market. And when I say market, it's not just the suppliers market. It's the, for the market, there is the other side of consumers also. If the consumers don't demand, the market will not supply. So both market in the sense. Unfortunately, whenever I mention market, people think that this fellow is working for the builders. That is not the case. Market is not only supplier side, there is a consumer side also of the market. So a well-functioning market means both the suppliers and the consumers are having a freedom to decide what they wish to do. So FSI incentive will be used in a limited scale for slum rehabilitation and sales building. Now this itself is a contentious issue. In a way, the government is promising 80% or 70% of Mumbai's population free houses. Not by spending public money, but by burdening the cost on the new companies. Now this is financially unsustainable proposition. But it had stayed politically so strong and so entrenched that we did not want to use DP as a way of pinching into that. So we have stayed clear. Otherwise, whatever other the noises that we are hearing, they would have become louder. So we have, and some of these things should really help in ease of doing business and reducing transaction costs, but I think that would be a tall claim. BNC is a very complex organization, and it's not so easy to bring those things up.
So I have one question. So it is well known that builders try to get permission for 4-5 stories. They always try to, I mean, get build one or two extra floors so that they can more money by selling flats and all this thing. So here, considering the flat, I mean, the house prices are actually 4-5 times more than the construction cost. So why do you think the builders will not go to whatever the allowable limit of FSI? And that will create, in my opinion, like lot of burden on lot of various things, including existing infrastructure like sewerage, water, transportation, and everything.
I think, to put it very crudely, floor space doesn't breed population. Population needs floor space. If the Mumbai's population hasn't been growing, in last 10 years it has grown from 11.9 to 12.45. Even 14, some of the demographers are saying 14 is an overestimate, it may not grow to 14. Now if that is the case, how much more floor space will it consume? So look at, developers are not also not fools, and the consumers are also not fools.
But
they will operate in the market.
But have you
seen that a lot of office spaces are lying empty in Mumbai, and no buyer?
I really don't know, but then why?
Yeah, that is the situation. So I think it's a game of the market, and
so then why Mumbai is considered so expensive? I mean, that's what.
Yeah, because regulations have added to prices. That is the whole that shape. If you don't allow market to operate, prices will go up. And smuggling of floor space will also happen. If you tightly control gold, what will happen? The prices will go up, and the smuggling of gold will also happen.
Aliyah may be an exception to the general thrust of comments you get from these public meetings, but based upon my understanding from your presentation on how the FSI was carefully and thoughtfully analyzed from a historical perspective and the rational basis that you just explained, how then it was distributed to accommodate future growth, I think it makes eminent sense the approach that you've taken. And perhaps the people who have understood or have not quite understood how FSI, extra FSI can apportion and how it has to meet certain conditions before it can be applied, perhaps they're misinformed or they're not fully informed about what the plan shows. But based upon the presentation that you made, I think it's a great plan in terms of the FSI part. I'm not commenting on the rest of the plan. But certainly from your presentation, I can see that there's a lot of good analysis, thoughtful analysis, historically and otherwise, that's gone into creating a justification for the extra FSI. Whether it's around TARs or lower areas get lower extra FSI, and what has happened in reality, already existing areas are beyond the current FSI limit of 1.33. So I have to commend you for a very thoughtful and very insightful analysis based upon which you made the recommendations for the FSI. Again, commenting on just the FSI portion of the plan, I know there's a lot of discussion going on about how some other things may have happened in the existing land use part, but this is very good.
Can you raise your hand?
Sir, my point was that because Mumbai has become expensive, the new population has moved to Navi Mumbai, and maybe it has also stopped some population from migrating inside Mumbai. So the high realty prices might have become a barrier for new people to come in. But when realty prices go down, as is proposed by increasing FSI, then the demand will also increase, and thus since regulations have allowed supply to increase, population growth rate will increase in Mumbai, and the 8 FSI limit will be met someday or the later if it is allowed on paper, or 8 or whatever, 3.54.
No, prices will get moderated, but not to the extent that the shift which is now occurring, because the shift is occurring on account of prices as well as dispersal of employment opportunities. New Bombay offers many employment opportunities. The whole Tanabilapur industrial belt is getting converted into offices and other concentrated employment zones. So people are moving on account of those things also. So the region as a whole, I think, if you put it in that context, then one has to analyze the housing market on a regional scale. Unfortunately, it was not within this mandate. But the plans then have to be prepared for the entire housing market. And this plan has alluded to that, that increasing FSI is not the only thing. You have to increase the supply of land also. And the increasing land supply in Mumbai is rather difficult because of its geography. And it can be done only by extending and investing into public transit. Because without public transit, you cannot really increase Mumbai's land supply. And that will be a different approach and story altogether, which has to be done on a regional scale.
So since the beginning you met, in the beginning there is no correlationship between density and FSI. So with this allocation of FSI, with distribution of FSI, do you think we get the desired density distribution also? Or if there was
not
a density distribution?
Not necessarily. See, the things can happen in a variety of ways. Say for example, the 6-point FSI case. 8 is only exceptional 0.5%. You take 6.5 FSI locations, which is at the intersection of two transit corridors. Now, whether that development occurs in the form of 2.5, 3 FSI with heavy car ownership, or whether you have smaller apartments, more like studio apartments, where people don't need good open spaces and schools and all those things, then you will get a higher population density. But how the market will operate is not so predictable. So won't be able to judge that. That is where the emphasis on monitoring and valuation. You need to track these things. Otherwise, if you wait for 20 years, then you wouldn't know what's happening.
Logically speaking, should the geological foundation, its structures, etc., the condition of the land, should it not be playing an important part in the FSI location?
I think Sudhir can answer that
question. Not such a major problem, because I think, like New York, we have a very good base rock. That is one part. Besides that, I think we can still go for with piles and with other foundations. So I think it's not such a major.
One of the issues about DCR, can technology not be used better, as is being used in a few cities in fact, to get the DCR to give information as a dynamic information as to what is the utilization of the built-up area and therefore the infrastructure, and that should in turn determine whether the premium FSI should be allowed or not. Because if you already utilized the infrastructure beyond certain limits, and that with GIS being used is now easily available as data, it should be, and there is no such thinking about using technology to really control the development, at least from what I see.
See, there is such widespread lag of infrastructure that if you really start matching the development to infrastructure, then you will have to lower the existing growth also. But your point is valid in a way that you will have to at one stage. At this stage, we haven't done that. But at one stage, impact assessment, like environment, do the environmental impact assessment. The impact assessment on in terms of infrastructure and other things will have to be brought in. But as of now, we haven't done that.
Yeah, but I mean, if you're looking at the coming 20-year horizon.
That is why every 5 years one has to look at it. So if you watch the BMC a little more closely, then you won't venture to suggest such things.
But I thought DP is a kind of an isolated activity where you can see much beyond.
How this DP has been put together itself is a, it could be a story. I think we have exceeded by half an hour.
fact that we've exceeded the time allotted by more than half an hour and people are still interested in asking serious questions shows the amount of interest there is in this process. And I think it's also a feature of the democratization of these processes that we have more than 25,000 people pointing out various kinds of changes and suggestions and modifications for the DP. So it's a reflection of the evolution of the process of decision making for these kinds of issues in India today. So I know that Mr. Phatak has been invited dozens, if not scores, of places to give these talks, and we thank him very much that in spite of having done this so many times, he still has the patience to listen to us and ask, answer all these questions in very detailed and minute ways. And details he went into terms of explaining the development plan, both in terms of the technical features as well as explaining it in lay terms. As an academic institution, I think we had certain kinds of objectives in organizing this talk, and I'm very happy that he touched upon both of these. One is in terms of an evidence-based planning, which is where I think we can contribute. And the second is in terms of explaining the larger logic behind the DP, because while we may accept some of the intentions behind the criticisms, we find that number one, evidence is lacking. Number two, the larger logic of the development plan is not always understood. So I think as critics and as people who want to see a better Mumbai, we can think of ways in which we can contribute to both of these kinds of research and contribution to the design of the development plan. So on behalf of IIT and all of us here, thank you very much, Mr. Hartley.